Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for coming. It's a great pleasure at the MEI today to introduce Dr. John Chalcraft from the London School of Economics, where he is an associate professor in the history and politics of empire and imperialism. His previous posts include a lectureship at the University of Edinburgh, a research fellowship at Gonville and Caius College, Cambridge, and his research focuses on labor, migration, and contentious mobilization in the Middle East. He is the author of The Striking Cabbies of Cairo and Other Stories, Crafts and Guilds in Egypt, 1863 to 1914, The Invisible Cage, Syrian Migrant Workers in Lebanon, that was from 2009, and most recently, The Popular Politics in the Making of the Modern Middle East, which is an unprecedentedly wide-ranging and in-depth history of revolutions, uprisings, movements, and diverse forms of protest in the Middle East and North Africa from the 18th century to the present, and that's what he'll be presenting today. So without further ado, Professor Chalcraft.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes, this is the book which became popularly known at Cambridge University Press as The Beast, because it's quite long, 610 pages. But I'm going to summarize it in 30 minutes or something. Is that right? About 35 minutes. So I hope I won't try your patience. But thank you very much for inviting me. It's a real pleasure to be here. I'll be interested to hear your reactions, because I haven't presented this in Southeast Asia before. And I would like to thank the Middle East Institute and the National University of Singapore for having me here. For all too short, my visit, but anyway, it's a pleasure. So my goal here is to present this book. It is supposed to be an unprecedentedly wide-ranging and in-depth history of protest in the Middle East and North Africa since the 18th century. It takes up a great variety of contentious collective action. That includes expressions of dissent, petitioning, liberty against the law, socio-political movements, uprisings, and revolutions. In the book, you'll find Islamist movements, nationalist, liberal, democratic, women's movements, and others. And they using repertoires and tactics that range from persuasion to institutional disruption to armed struggle. The book centers on the dynamics of transgressive mobilization, defined as collective action that breaks the rules of existing politics, challenges forms of political monopoly and exclusion, brings new entrants into the political field, and often forges new collective actors and solidarities. The book's in four parts. It goes back to the late 18th century, and it's based around many case studies involving episodes of contention. It draws on a wide range of secondary literature in English, French, and Arabic, and some archives and primary sources, with a particular focus on treatises, autobiographies, and writings of activists themselves. It's written against neo-Orientalism, that tradition of thinking of protest as something which emerges from a culture of being a Muslim or being an Arab or some other immutable cultural category. It's also written against top-down accounts of politics and their lack of attention to the importance of consent and resistance. It stands on the shoulders of traditions of historical sociology and historical materialism, while taking issue with their socioeconomic determinism and their modernist telos. It draws a great deal from post-colonialism's deconstruction of modernist meta-narrative, but it writes quite strongly against post-colonialism's erasure of subaltern voice and struggles, its overemphasis on culture, and its treatment of discourse as an overwhelming mechanism of social control. It borrows quite a lot from theories of contentious politics and social movements theory, while challenging their bias towards methodological individualism and micrology, and their lack of a theory of consent and dissent. And what it offers to those scholarly conversations is to say we have to bring consent and dissent back in and pose the question of hegemony. The book aims at a rich political history from below, and it studies forms of hegemony, consent, and dissent, and it unpacks the dynamics of transgressive mobilization, especially by considering things like the translocal appropriation of models for contentious collective action, the importance of intellectual labor, the importance of normative commitments, and of leadership, meaning organization, strategies, and tactics. It aims to shed light on popular politics, without which I argue we can't understand the making of the post-colonial Middle East and North Africa. So in the time that remains, I'll give a historical overview of what's in the book and its main historical arguments. Part one of the talk. In part two of this talk, I will say something about the interpretive framework in which the book is couched, and then I'll conclude. So to begin with the historical overview of what's in the book and its main arguments. Part one of the book goes from 1798 to 1914. It's called Millenarianism, Renewal, Justice, Rights, and Reform. And you'll find many episodes of contention, the uprising against the Napoleonic occupation of Egypt, 1798 to 1801, long struggles against French colonization in Algeria, millenarian uprisings in Egypt from the 1810s to the 1860s, Abdel Kader al-Jazeri's Islamic revivalist and state-building projects in Algeria in the 1830s and 40s. There are commoner uprisings against taxation in the Mushrik, the Arab East, including the remarkable popular Republican uprising of Tanis Shaheen in the Kisrawan district of Mount Lebanon between 1858 and 1860. There is a section on tribes, Sufis, and pretenders, and millenarians in Morocco in the late 19th century. There's a piece on the Mahdiya, the Mahdi, the expected deliverer of Sudan in the 1880s. There's a discussion of strikes and protests among workers before parties, socialism, and unions. There's a section on the Arabi movement in Egypt, the constitutional movement there, 1881 to 82, and in Istanbul in 1908. So those are some of the cases that the book takes up in part one. It situates these contests and episodes of contention above all in a context of state strengthening in the region. The three major states of the region in the 19th century, the Qajar, Iran, the Ottoman Empire, and Alawi, Morocco, under pressure from the European powers, engage in processes of state strengthening, and they set in motion all sorts of vectors of extraction, regulation, conscription, new processes of centralization, as well as forms of weakness, corruption, and indebtedness. In this context, revolutionary movements, the book argues, were not proto-nationalist movements. Revolutionary movements during the 19th century, they sought to replace the state with a new kind of political community, not under nationalist banners, but under those banners of Islamic revival, Sufism, and heterodoxy, and millenarianism. More reformist kinds of protests during the century sought to win concessions from the state or carve out spheres of autonomy under the banners not of labor socialism or of liberalism, but of in terms of powerful living traditions in regards to the Sultan's justice, notions of rights, about just shares, and forms of custom, both tribal and urban. Also, you had urban reformists who sought to lodge principles of representation in the state who lacked mass constituencies before the First World War. The argument here is that the 19th century was not a dress rehearsal for something that came later, a more fully formed 20th century politics of nationalism, liberalism, and socialism. Instead, it's about powerful traditions of popular protest. They were not half-formed or deviant versions of more complete European models. They were not backward, pre-political, or archaic, but instead they were built around changing, diverse Islamic, Ottoman traditions and customs. On the negative side, these movements sometimes drew in colonial violence. They often encountered brutal repression, and they could end in sectarian conflict. On the other side, more positively, they could blunt extraction by the powerful. They could secure, and did secure, rights and just shares. They enacted justice against local exploiters. They cut against corruption. They could draw on and entrench new kinds of state regulation, and they temporarily generated new kinds of statehood and political community. And in certain cases, lodged new principles of representation in the state. Part two of the book goes from 1914 to 1952. It's called Patriotism, Liberalism, Armed Struggle, and Ideology. It makes a great deal of the rugged armed struggles under the banners of nation and Islam that broke out in the region between 1911 and 1939, especially in Libya, Iraq, Syria, Morocco, and eventually Palestine. It also looks at the mass insurrection in Egypt in 1919, the young Algerians and Mesali El Hajj, the labor movement in Egypt, nationalists, Shia, workers, and peasants in Iraq, the national bloc in Syria, women's movements in Egypt, the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood, and a few other cases. The main explanatory context for this period, it's not modernization or the development of peripheral capitalism, and it has much more to do with dynamics at the level of the political community. The collapse of the Ottoman Empire, the direct and invasive forms of imperialism that the region encounters, and then the growing crises of these semi-independent states and their politicians and leaderships. These political dynamics break the existing state framework and impose a different one. There are invasive new forms of state power, whether on the Jebel Druze in Syria or in the Rif Mountains of Morocco. They also generate new and powerful forms of exclusion, from Zionist settler colonialism in Mandate Palestine to Italian settler colonialism in what becomes Libya. These dynamics also offer all sorts of alliances to those who are ready to seize them. In this context, revolutionary movements demanded independence, above all under nationalist banners, which blended and joined hands with notions of independence conceived in Islamic terms. More reformist movements, they demanded not just or not anymore the Sultan's justice, but reform of the social system, whether in terms of Islam, socialism, or liberalism. New struggles drew heavily on older organizational forms, traditions of protest and forms of moral economy, but they reformulated them in new terms. So the guilds and the Sufi orders were replaced by unions and mass societies. In this book, the interwar period is not defined by the beginnings of socioeconomic contradictions that later become more full-blown. The argument is that independence is so much emphasized, not because these struggles are superficial political struggles that lacked socioeconomic content, but because political community and its radical transformation really was at stake during these years. Nor were these movements a kind of borrowing from Europe, a modernist graft onto a backward population. Nationalism comes to the fore not because it expresses a socioeconomic development, but because nationalism was able to hegemonize diverse constituencies, living traditions, and ideas, including religious and jihad traditions. And the development of new ideological forms draws heavily on reformulated but powerful traditions of protest. The generation of 1919 did not achieve national independence in the Arabic-speaking world, and transformation of the system on socialist, Islamic, or liberal lines was not achieved. And in many cases, uprisings were brutally crushed. That's on the negative side. But on the more positive side, these movements made national independence the key stake in relations with European powers. They made national aspirations hegemonic in the social formation as a whole. They changed the terms of colonial rule from direct to indirect in Egypt, Iraq, and Syria. They pushed forward state centralization in places like the Rif Mountains. They stitched the tribes into state formation into Iraq and Jordan. It's not just a top-down process. They make social reform, whether in regard to labor or women's issues or education, a burning issue. And they develop new vehicles of mass organization, syndicates, unions, mass societies like the Muslim Brotherhood, and so on. And they contribute over time in a major way to the unsustainability of the semi-colonial order. Part three of the book goes from 1952 to 1976. It's called National Independence, Guerrilla War, and Social Revolution. It starts with Nasser's revolutionary coup in Egypt in 1952 and looks at some similar coups in Iraq, North Yemen, and then Libya in 69, and also attempted coups in the 50s in Saudi Arabia. It studies the armed struggles in Algeria, South Yemen, and Palestine from 1954 to the 1970s, looks at the rise of Baathism in Syria, strikes and protests in various parts of the Arabian Peninsula, and leftist movements in Lebanon until 1976. Again, the main explanatory context is not rooted in a modernist telos, whether about the development of modernity or of statist capitalism. And certainly it's not about the strains of modernization that drive kind of backward masses to adopt extremist ideologies, that kind of Cold War type explanation. Instead, the key explanatory context is the crisis of a colonially controlled, partially liberal political order that's bequeathed by the interwar years. Nationalist independence and social reform were burning issues, but the generation of 1919, to speak metonymically, had not delivered, and this was a galvanizing crisis that stirs mass mobilization. In that context, movements aim to bring about national independence, and they aim to drive through far-reaching social and economic reform and the redistribution of wealth. And very dramatically, they look to the state as the agent of change in so many cases. The period witnesses, of course, dramatic forms of mobilization, but also a certain kind of a vanguardism which displaces forms of mass mobilization. So you have fronts, committees, and cells which were at work as much as or acted to replace mass societies, political parties, or independent union movements. So we can't speak of the rise and rise of mass national politics. Instead, you have this starts to be curtailed by a new authoritarianism by the 70s, and vanguardism and statism had some elective affinities with authoritarian rule. And so movements must bear some responsibility for the authoritarianism that develops in the state in the 50s and 60s in the region. On the other hand, their achievements in bringing about national independence and contributing to real social and economic distribution are not contested in the book. They're underlined, in fact. Part four of the book goes from 1977 to 2011. It's called Islamism, Revolution, Uprisings, and Liberalism. And there are studies of the uprising in Egypt in 1977, the first one of masses against a post-independence regime, and strike action and left protest in Egypt. There's a look at Shiism in Iraq, from pamphlets to Mujahideen. There's a study of the Muslim Brotherhood in Syria from 1963 to 1982, and in Egypt, and the militant Sunni jihad splinter groups that came off the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt. There's a study of the Iranian Revolution, of Lebanon and Hezbollah, of Salafi Wahhabism, and the taking on of the far enemy, i.e. the US in 2001, of the reform movement in Iran in the 1990s, the independence intifada in Lebanon in 2005, the return of liberal and left protest in Egypt in the 2000s, the BDS, the boycott divestment sanctions movement for Palestinian rights, and a section on the Arab uprisings with some attention to the fate of the liberals in Egypt. Again, the main explanatory context is not some pre-existing macro process of globalization or the development of neoliberal capitalism. Instead, it again centers on issues around consent and hegemony. It's about the incapacity of the formerly revolutionary republics to win the consent of their populations on the one side, and the attempt of states such as Saudi Arabia to legitimate themselves on revamped Salafi Wahhabi lines on the other. These political dynamics involve authorities rolling back on socio-economic rights and gains, drawing back from pan-Arabism and third worldism, failing often enough to bring democracy and prosperity, provoking huge numbers by police violence, torture, and humiliation, and the sponsorship of Salafi Wahhabism, an absolutist and sectarian form of Islam, by the Saudi royal house in order to justify its absolutist rule. It promotes a very widely rejected form, that had been very widely rejected form of Islam in the region for the previous centuries. And invasion and occupation from without, ongoing Israeli settler colonization, and the machinations of other external powers have generated major dissenting constituencies. In this context, the more revolutionary movements aim to replace the secular state with an Islamic state, whether in Shia popular, Sunni modernist, or Salafi Wahhabi colors. Or they sought to throw off occupation under banners both Islamic and secular nationalist. In one case, that of the boycott, divestment, sanctions movement, aim is taken at settler colonialism by a translocal, radically democratic, and post-nationalist project. The other end of the spectrum, movements such as Al-Qaeda, sought to bring down the far enemy, i.e. the United States. 2011 involved mass uprisings that sought to bring down corrupted regimes on the basis of universal forms of popular sovereignty, bread, dignity, and freedom. More reformist movements in this context, they aim to reform state and society on Islamic and pious lines, or to assert, restore, and recover social and economic rights against heavy threats, to push for the rights of women in different ways, or to push back against dictatorship, bringing liberal, representative, and democratic principles and human rights norms to bear in the state. On the more negative side, these movements have contributed directly and indirectly to sectarian conflict in Iraq and Syria, as well as in Algeria in the 90s. They've sometimes been brutally repressed at great cost. They've not halted colonization in Palestine. In many cases, they've been unable to prevent the growth and growth of the security state. They've contributed to revolutions that have devoured their children, and the new religious politics has brought about new forms of social conservatism, with all the implications this has for restrictions on sexual, gender, and women's freedoms. On the more positive side, Hezbollah did succeed in terminating Israel's long occupation of South Lebanon in 2000. Others, from Bahrain to Egypt, have kept alive the idea that human rights, representative institutions, and democratic forms should be promoted in the face of dictatorship, corruption, and monarchy. Other movements have contributed to the making of Islamic forms of democracy, both in theory and practice. And we've seen in Tunisia positive liberal democratic outcomes in the wake of mass uprisings and tenacious organized contention. Other movements have protected public sector and industrial workers against deteriorating pay and conditions and kept the social question alive in an age of neoliberalism. So that's something of a historical overview of the book. I said I would say something about the interpretive framework as well in which the book is couched. And at the heart of the book is this transgressive mobilization. And it was partly something that was triggered when I was reading a PhD by Sonia Nimmer about the memories of the Palestine revolt of 1936-9. And she spoke to some Palestinians. She was doing oral history back in the 1980s. And they said to her, she said, you know, oh, what happened in the 1930s? They said, quote, the people defied the authorities and took matters into their own hands. And this is a very tantalizing phrase, And it has to do with this sort of seizure of doctrinal and political agency in the face usually of political monopolies and forms of exclusion from below. And whether authorities like it or not, and they usually do not, ordinary people who are excluded from transacted and official politics persist in seeking to engage in political action. Sometimes they try to take matters into their own hands. They break the rules of existing politics. They challenge forms of exclusion. They're unruly in this double sense. They're unruly because they break the rules, but they're also unruly because they are not under the control of any one actor. And new entrants appear in the political field, and often new collective actors and forms of solidarity are formed. So that's the idea of transgressive mobilization. We saw that spectacularly in 2011. But this history tries to say that you go back and you find that this dynamics of transgressive mobilization have been there since the 18th century. And it's not a result of a modernist telos, nor is it rooted in some cultural essence from the region. Instead, we have to think very seriously about how the dynamics of transgressive mobilization, they don't emerge from some kind of pre-existing sociological determinism, which is the always the tendency in historical sociology, whether it's print capitalism, whether it's the colonial state, whether it's the spread of communications technology, whether it's the internet, there's always supposed to be some sociological surrogate parent for the making of transgressive mobilization. Well, in this book, that isn't the case. And I mean, just to mention an example from one of the foremost chroniclers of Egypt in 1798, someone called Al-Jabarti. He's a senior cleric who witnesses the Napoleonic invasion. And just listen to what he writes about the people who engaged in the uprising. He says, in Cairo, a well-known cleric came forward, quote, mounted on a steed in extraordinary military fashion. It was leading crowds from the Al-Hussein quarter. He says the crowd became, it's extraordinary because clerics aren't supposed to get on horses because that's something reserved for the military and administrative class. So there's this transgression that's happening. He says the crowd became huge and full of the poor and those of low status. He says ruffians and inhabitants of lodgings. You know, he's critical, he's always critical. Al-Jabarti is critical of everything, but he's certainly critical of these people. He says, anyway, they gather in front of the Al-Hussein Mosque and the Al-Azhar Seminary and the chief judge's house to demand what faith, law, and justice required. And then Al-Jabarti goes on. He says, a perfumer among them. So this is like someone who sells various things. He says, quote, dressed up in the guise of a cleric. So you have a cleric who is mounted on a steed, and now you have a perfumer pretending to be a cleric with a vest and a waistcloth. He came forward calling out to the people, incited them, and exclaimed, Muslims, God is most great, you know, strike the infidel, and so on. He's particularly unhappy about a popular leader called Al-Maghribi. He says, quote, he interfered in things which do not concern him, and he appeared in town like the Pasha and the Kethkuda and the Mamluks, the Ottoman officials. He says, what is he that he appoints himself without having been appointed by anybody? It is civil strife which turns any ignoble bird into a vulture, especially when the rabble riots and the mob and the riffraff rises. So this is a sour, conservative description of the transgressive seizure of political and doctrinal agency from below. So it, just to illustrate very briefly what I mean when I say you find this transgressive mobilization in the 18th century and you find it in the present. So it's not the result of some linear process that has to do with the advent of capitalist modernity. That's part of one of the things the book tries to establish. And so how do we then develop a context for thinking about it? Well, I think in terms of hegemony and consent at the level of the state. So states and political authorities find ways to secure the consent of their populations. They co-opt, they legitimate, they provide spaces of autonomy, they deliver efficaciously or not, and so on. They allow participation. So there are various mechanisms whereby hegemony is thickened and developed. You get hegemonic incorporation. Well, these mechanisms can break down. And often it's the failure of the authorities that's at stake. But when this happens, you have dissenting constituencies who are made available for transgressive mobilization. And this is part of this history. I mean, from the derelictions of the Mamluks and the protection of Egypt, so swingingly criticized by Al-Jabarti, this chronicler, to, for instance, the major blow to the authority of the Saudi state in 1990 when it allows American troops onto its own soil to defend itself against Iraq, when critics say, well, we spend all this money on arms, why can't we defend the holy places ourselves? And now you've let the Americans in. It gives rise to a wave of movements. And you see this through the history. You have it in the failures of the civilian leaderships, liberals and politicians of the interwar period. In many ways, it was the generation of 1948 that lost faith in the generation of 1919. Just to give you an example of this from 67. So after the Arab states are defeated egregiously by Israel in 1967, this is a snippet from the memoir of somebody who went to fight for the PLO. And so he's a student, Lebanese, in Beirut, 1967. And he says, well, the 67 war, it was, quote, a major shock to the whole Arab nation. He says it woke people up to what was going on around them. He says this defeat took me from just a general political interest to a direct political commitment. He says he started, in fact, quote, to conduct research in political magazines with a disgust for mere rhetoric and a desire for effectiveness and direct action. And he says everyone started trying to plan a way or a political method or an idea to find a solution here or there. And anyway, then he's somebody who's very impressed by the Fatah faction of the PLO who show bravery at the Battle of Karama in 1968, shortly after the defeat of 67, and he flocks to their ranks. So you can see how this galvanizing crisis of 67 engages a kind of a vector of politicization. And this is the sort of idea of hegemonic contraction that is an enabling condition. When mechanisms that win consent break down, you have enabling conditions for transgression. And I'm not going to go on for too long, but of course, the book tries to explore how transgressive mobilization is shaped, because even though it's a very unstructured affair, it's a very creative affair, because rules are being broken, new subjects are being forged. But still, we can understand something of how it works. And one of the things the book makes a lot of is this thing I mentioned at the beginning, translocal appropriation of models for contentious collective action, especially coevally, like at the same time. It's this unruly and rapid appropriation of, by large numbers of new entrants into the political field, of models for collective action that are out there. I mean, this was dramatic in 2011, this idea that you go to the square and you occupy it and you don't leave until your demands have been met. It's a very particular model. It happened in Benghazi, happened in Tahrir, happened in Kasaba, in Tunis, then it happened in Pearl Roundabout. I mean, in Bahrain, it's quite interesting. I mean, Pearl Roundabout, it's not a center of regime power. It was just happened to be a roundabout that was sort of between Manama, the capital, and the villages, so it was a convenient place to go. But I mean, and it also happened in Syria. But this model, you have what I call piracy, this unauthorized appropriation of an idea, which can then shape the vectors of transgressive mobilization. But you see it throughout the history of the region. And one case, like the idea of the general strike, it's the civil servants of Egypt who up until that time, they've never been on strike, and they've certainly never had a general strike. But in 1919, there are general strikes in Europe, and the civil servants say, well, what about if we have a general strike here in Egypt, a nationalist general strike? And they implement it, and the British are very shocked. They can't believe it. What's going on? The civil servants, a general strike? We've never heard of such a thing. And then there's a 50-day general strike in Syria in 1936, which leads to the successful moment when Hesham al-Atassi goes to Paris and he signs an independence treaty and he comes back. And the Palestinians in 36, they see this and they say, oh, we can have a general strike. And that's how they begin in 36. That's how their uprising of 36 to 39 begins, with a general strike. Just been shown to be successful in Syria on and on. Although then later it's not successful in Syria because the Leon Blum government doesn't ratify the treaty that they've signed. But anyway, so you see this, and you see, I mean, looking at the armed struggles of the interwar period, you have this armed struggle in Turkey with Ataturk, etc. Well, Abdülkerim of the Rif Mountains, he is inspired by Ataturk, and he wants to do something similar. And then Al-Kawukji, who's fighting in Syria in 1925, is inspired by Abdülkerim Al-Khattabi in the Rif Mountains of Morocco. You have it, and I won't go on and on, but just one more, the idea of the people's revolutionary guerrilla war. It's a third worldist idea. Of course, Chairman Mao was the first person to really expound it in 1937 in his pamphlet on guerrilla war, but it becomes big after Havana, 1959, Vietnam later, and the Palestinians get this idea, the people's organized guerrilla war. And a lot of the pamphlets of the more radical sections of the PLO, they seize on this idea. It's going to be a people's, and it's very interesting. It's always instated locally in a complex way. It's translated, becomes something totally different. But it is, you have this model for collective action that gets, you know, taken, and it shapes the vectors of transgressive mobilization, which in and of itself doesn't have any rules. And like, I think probably I've been going for 35 minutes, but the other themes in the book are intellectual labor. I make a big play of the role of intellectual labor in shaping the contours of how you get from transgressive mobilization to more permanent kinds of socio-political movement. There's a lot of intellectual activities in this book. I mean, all the way from if you want to develop it, we can speak about it. But I also have something about normative commitment. Again, perhaps we'll talk about that more in the discussion if necessary. But it enables people, it motivates people, it provides a basis for social cohesion in the face of adversity, and it offers a cause which can compel adherence. The book also has quite a lot to say because you have the vectors of transgressive mobilization, but then the fate and fortunes of mobilizing projects are partly in the hands of the fateful decisions that organizers, leaders, and others make. And I make quite a lot of that. I mean, for example, you compare the Egyptian uprising of 1977 with the Algerian uprising of 1988. They're both ostensibly bread riots. They're both responses to unemployment and raising prices and so on. And in the Egyptian case, nobody moves in to mobilize people. Really nobody. And the left says, oh my goodness, this has nothing to do with us. In Algeria in 1988, the Islamists move in and they say, oh, this is everything to do with us. And they mobilize. And it makes a big difference to the subsequent, the Intifada, the Palestinian Intifada of 1987. The opening drama of the Palestinian Intifada of 87 is youth from refugee camps who throw up burning tires to prevent the Israeli army coming in. Well, it's not organized factions, it's youth, it's transgressive mobilization. Then the factions and NGOs and all sorts of other people get involved, and it's that organization that's enabled to sustain this process for 2, 3, 4 years. So anyway, those are some of the themes of the book: leadership, intellectual labor, normative commitment, translocal appropriation, and they're designed to help us understand the dynamics of transgressive mobilization, which, as I say, is not something that springs from something authentic to the region, and nor is it something that's wrapped up in some modernist story about modernization or the development of capitalism or globalization. But it's more, it has to do with how political authorities win and lose consent within the political field. So to conclude, the book makes a pitch, you won't be surprised to hear by now, for the importance of transgressive mobilization in the history of the region and in the history of its changing political dispensations. The argument is that we need to write this history with the protest left in. Protest can't be dismissed as sort of recalcitrant people, as in the language of security studies and Orientalism, nor can it be ignored, as in top-down accounts that focus on elites and powerful institutions. And it's also unsatisfactory to try and explain this history through the historical sociologist's beloved trajectory of capitalist modernity, which then goes into a kind of postmodern phase after the 1970s. It's too materialist, it's too teleological, it's too Eurocentric, and it doesn't do justice to agency, culture, and politics. Many of the outcomes of this transgressive mobilization and trajectories, they emerge from the interactions that take place and for forms of organization and strategy and so on. They can't be predicted in advance, and they can't be read off the social structure. The old social history is not adequate in this regard. Nor how the struggle to bring about hegemony in the Middle East and North Africa is not a pale copy of a version pioneered or not in Europe. It has its own specific trajectories. But you can see that, you know, this owes something to the post-colonial critique of modernism, but the idea here is to challenge this post-colonial indifference to the protests and passions of the many, and a kind of Eurocentric post-modernism. It's an attempt to recover a more engaged and political form of history writing from below, actually in a context where cultural history and discursive history has had the initiative, especially the latter, and especially in the United States. As I mentioned, there's plenty of borrowing from social movements theory and contentious politics, but I say we need to bring back consent and dissent back into that picture. Those things are largely absent from theorizing about social movements, which is much more methodologically individualist or micrological, and I want to say that those forms of consent and dissent are vital to in order to make sense of the history. So finally, it's an attempt at a history of popular politics, these attempts by ordinary people to interfere in sectorized and transacted politics that affects them, but it often excludes them. That's not supposed to be a populist history. Instead, it's supposed to be about something more real. It's not about the manipulation of the popular, but it's about how attempts to transform situations of exclusion. And I mean, the wager is that this is a theme which is important now, as it has been for a long time, but now amid all sorts of political breakdown, we should watch this idea, and it'll probably continue to be important for some years to come. But thank you for listening.